It's Martin here, the man of your art. So today, me and Rachel are out in Winchcombe, which is a beautiful medieval village in Gloucestershire. And we're looking for a treasure from England's past, St. Kenelm's Well, an old holy well. Now, you don't get many holy wells in the north, and so this will be the first one I've ever seen. There was one nearby to my home village up in Cumbria near Humphrey Head, but there wasn't really anything left and not really a monument to it. But this is one of these proper southern Saint Wells that you find. And it's got an absolutely superb story to it as well, amazing legend and folk tale. So I hope you enjoy it, and we're going to go and find it. See you in a bit. Sudley Castle, which is sadly closed at the moment, but is amazing to look at nonetheless. This is actually the home of one of my favourite kings, Richard III, when he was only the Duke of Gloucester. And so he owned Sudley Castle, but shortly after the Battle of Tewkesbury, he was made Lord of the North and Warden of the North. He swapped Sudley for a Yorkshire castle, Richmond, which I've been to as well. So one of his main residences up in the north. To create a power base up there, basically. He did get Sudley back though when he became king, because he swapped it with his brother Edward IV. And so when Edward died and Richard became king, it was royal land, so he got Sudley back in the end anyway. Whether he would have lived in it much as king is doubtful though. But yeah, amazing castle.
Thank you.
like anyone's been here for a long time. A forgotten shrine. So, Kenelm was the son of Kenelm, King of Mercia. So this is all back in the 8th century when Britain was divided into different kingdoms. Kenelm had three children, and they all had fantastic Anglo-Saxon names that need to be revived. You've got Kenelm, you've got Quenfrith, and you've got Bergen Hilda as well. So these are fantastic Anglo-Saxon names. Now, Quenfrith was very jealous of the 7-year-old Kenelm, who was very holy and a very devout boy, and she decided that she wanted the throne for herself. So when their venerable father, Kenelm, the great king of the Mercians, passed away, she got her lover, Ascobert, to take Kenelm into the woods, and there he beheaded him. Now strangely, after this murderous act was committed, a little white dove flew out of his head. And where his head landed, a spring sprang up and a well was formed. Now that's not this well, that's actually a well that's in Worcestershire. No one knew of the vile act, and Quenfrith, when she became queen, she decreed that no one should ever mention her brother Kenelm's name again. But this little white dove, it flew all the way to Rome. And in Rome, it went into St. Peter's Basilica and found the Pope. And there it laid on his table a little piece of parchment written on in Old English. Now the Pope, of course, he thought to himself he can't speak anything but Latin and Italian and things. So he got his bishops to translate it for him, which he had some Anglo-Saxon bishops in court. Now, when he translated the message, he was very disturbed to find that it was accusing Quenfrith of the murder of Kenelm, with directions as to where to find his body. So he sent a delegation of his Anglo-Saxon bishops to find Kenelm's body, and they found it in Romsley. Now the monks employed by these bishops found a thicket in Romsley, and around it was shining an ethereal light, and there was a bright spectral calf that led them to a little thicket. So they began digging, and they found the gruesome remains of Kenelm with his head not attached. Now, they began to take the body back to Winchcombe, but along the way, they met up with trouble from some other monks from another diocese. And it's strange, so there must have been some kind of fracas, because these poor monks had to escape from the other ones and had to run with the body of Kenelm, probably in a casket or a coffin, to escape for their murderous intentions. They eventually made it just outside Winchcombe and came here, where this well is today. They planted their staffs in the ground, and where they planted their staffs, water sprang up, a miracle brought to them by God. So they had to quench their thirst, and it gave them rejuvenated energy to get back to Winchcombe, where they could inter his body. Now Quenfrith, on the other hand, she was reading a psalter in the old Mercian Minster here at Winchcombe, and she heard the bells tolling to celebrate Kenelm's return. And she said, "If that is Kenelm's body returned, then may my eyes drop out upon this book." And of course, like most saint stories, her eyes plopped out onto the book, which I think is fitting justice for the murder of such a holy saint. So now their wells, which all record the saint's journey here to Winchcombe, in which this is one of them, and probably the most important and most well preserved. The building that I'm in is actually much later. There was an Elizabethan shrine, but now this is kind of like an 18th century shrine for wayfarers to stop and take refreshment on their long journeys. And I myself might have a drink of its holy waters. fancy being grassed up by a bird. I just love these amazing, strange, supernatural stories attached to saints around this country. They're all little stories that are slowly becoming lost in popular consciousness, but they're still there, and the little buildings and shrines and wells still attest to them. So yeah, what an amazing little place to find. I can't believe that I just saw it randomly on an OS map. I had no idea where this place was, and I just saw it on an OS map and thought, gosh, I wonder what that is. Maybe I should research it. So anyway, this shrine is probably really ancient, and it's likely that there may have been a pagan well here at one time. As you know, that Iron Age peoples used to deposit ritual goods to the waters in their kind of old religion. And I remember reading when I researched this place just before we drove out that someone believed it was a megalith just in this grove as well. And I think what they might be talking about is this little stone just behind me in the foliage. So if you can see that, it's just like a little stone. Now that could be anything really. It could be just an old boulder, or even an old lynchet for a wall or something like that. But never know, maybe this was a druidic grove at one point as well. And then as Christianity came into England, it's been taken over. They've attached this story to it to sanctify it in a different way. But anyway, amazing little treasure in the countryside. So we're back to the beginning now, back in Winchcombe, and that's the end of the walk. Oh gosh, that is such an amazing sight, and a true relic of old England. And it's amazing that these little treasures are still hidden out in the countryside, and not many people know about them really. So it was great to find, and just to think that I just happened to see that on the OS map and thought, oh, I wonder what that is. And it's actually something quite fascinating, such an amazing story. So we're going to head back now. The intention was to go to Tewkesbury Battlefield site as well to trace the old 1471 War of the Roses battle. Me and my dad and brother went and did a walk a few years ago, and I wanted to show Rachel it and make a little video about it as well. But we're just running out of time. I faffed around a bit this morning and took ages to get out, and I think we only got out for 1:30. So anyway, we're still on our holiday, and hopefully we're going to go kayaking tomorrow on the Kennet Avon Canal, which will be really exciting. So hope everyone has a lovely weekend, and see you all soon. Bye.
Bye.